The Diamond Sutra, Creating Determination. First, you were searching for many lives for the door, and then you started knocking for many lives. Now the door is found open, and Buddha says you remain outside the door. There are many who need to be helped. Naturally, a great desire to enter, a great passion to enter through the door will arise. That is what Subhati finds himself in this situation. He is a bodhisattva. Any moment he can become a Buddha. But Buddha asked him to stay on. After these words, the Lord said to Subhati, "Therefore, Subhati, listen well and attentively. Someone who has set out in the vehicle of a bodhisattva should produce a thought in this manner. It does not look very good in English translation. The Sanskrit word is chittopad. Chitt means memory, that aspect. One should create such a mind or such a decision. One should create such a great decision or determination. This is meant by the word chittopad. And this has to be done in a particular manner." And Buddha explains, this is the manner. "And many beings are there in the universe of the being, comprehended under the term beings. All these I must lead to nirvana. Many who are on the verge, and I must lead all these to nirvana. Not one, not two, Subhati, not one, not two, but all the beings, men, women, animals, birds, trees and rocks, the entire creation, sentient and insentient, all the beings in the world. One should create such a determination that I will lead all of them into nirvana." This is the mind that Buddha is asking Subhuti to create. "I will lead all of them into nirvana." Into that realm of nirvana which leaves nothing behind. And yet, although innumerable beings have thus been led to nirvana, no being at all has been led to nirvana. That too you have to remember. You should not forget. Otherwise, leading others, you will fall into ignorance again. All the beings have to be led into the other shore, and still you have to remember that their miseries are false. So your remedies are also false. And you have to remember that they have no selves, neither do you have any self. So do not forget this. And also do not think that you are helping people and that you are a great helper. This is that, otherwise you will fall again. The moment you think you are helping others or you are a great master, you have fallen back again. Again you will grow the roots on this shore. Yes, things are happening and you are a witness to all that is happening. The others are led into reaching the other shore. And that is what is very important. You must remember that. So two things you have to remember. You have to remain on this shore with a great determination. Otherwise you will be pulled by the other shore. I have to stay on as long as my work is there. There are many who needs to be led into the other shore. The determination of the doctor that I am going to stay on in the job, because there are many patients and there is not many doctors who could cure the patients of this particular disease. There is an outburst of a particular virus. I must help the patients to get to the other shore, which is health. And yet, you are not to grow the roots again, otherwise you will not be of any help to others. How would you create the roots? By thinking that I am a great master, I am helping many. I am not helping, there is a presence that surrounds me. There is an awareness that overflows. It is that which is helping the people to grow. You will destroy yourself, you will fall into the dream again. You can help only because you have no more roots on this shore. And why? If in a bodhisattva the notion of a being should take place, he should not be called a bodhi being. And why is it so? He is not to be called a bodhi being in whom the notion of the self or of a being should take place, or the notion of living soul or of a person. So you have to remember, Subhuti, two things. One, that you have to leave all the beings to the other shore. And still you have to remember that nobody has a being, neither you nor they. All egos are false and illusion. Go on remembering this and go on with great determination. Help people to reach to the other shore. They are already there. You have to make them alert and aware, but never get lost or become a savior. These two things remember, these two things. And again Buddha repeats this in this particular sutra. The vehicle of the bodhisattva. I would like you all to become bodhisattvas. Remember, love is the fragrance of no mind. No mind has nothing to do with the mind. It is not the extension of the mind. You have to understand that no mind cannot arise out of mind. It is not a growth of the mind. Also, it is not continuity with the mind either. Instead, it is discontinuity. It is as discontinuous as disease is with health. Health does not arise out of disease. Health arises when disease is no more. Disease was continuing and was invading the space and was not allowing the health to blossom. And the moment disease is no more, health blossoms. Its fragrance reaches far and wide. The disease has to be removed first. It is like a rock blocking the path of a small spring. You remove the rock and the spring starts flowing profusely without any restriction. And the flow does not arise out of the rock. The rock was blocking it. The rock was a block. So is the mind. Mind is the block for no mind. Mind is the block for bliss, harmony and love. No mind simply means that which is not mind at all. How can it arise out of the mind then? If it arises out of the mind, it may be a super mind, but it cannot be no mind. That is where I differ from Sri Aurobindo. He talks about the supermind. A supermind is the same mind, yet more decorated, more cultured, more cultivated, more sophisticated, stronger and more integrated. However, all the more it is the same old mind. Buddha says, not super mind, instead no mind. Not super soul, instead no soul. Not super individuality or super self, but no self. And he uses the word anatta. Buddha uses the word anatta. That is where Buddha is unique and his understanding is the deepest. A super mind is a growth and no mind is a leap, a jump, a transcendence, and there is a vast difference between the two. The no mind has nothing to do with the mind at all. Both no mind and mind never meet one another because one is the absence of the other. Just as disease and health never exist together, health is the absence of disease, and disease is the absence of the health. They never encounter one another. When mind is there, no mind is no more. And when no mind is there, mind cannot exist. They never even say hello to each other because the two can never meet. The presence of the one is necessarily the absence of the other. So remember this. Buddha again and again reminds Subhuti. So remember it. That is why I say Aurobindo never became enlightened. He remained polishing the mind. He was a great mind. But to a great mind is not to be enlightened. So too Bertrand Russell is a great mind, but to be a great mind is not to be enlightened. Friedrich Nietzsche is another great mind. Both Aurobindo and Nietzsche have many similarities. Nietzsche talks about Superman and Aurobindo talks about supermind. There are similarities, but the Superman will be a projected man. A superman will be this man. However, all the weaknesses destroyed, all the strengths strengthened, but still this is man. Bigger than man, stronger and higher too, is still on the same wavelength or the same ladder. There is no radical change, but there has never been a discontinuity. Between mind and no mind, there is discontinuity. No mind means discontinuity with all that you are. You have to die for no mind to be. This is why the Master says, or Jesus said to Nicodemus, you have to die as you are only to be reborn. So the first thing you inquire, is it possible that no mind evolves quite naturally out of the mind? No, indeed, it does not. No mind is not an evolution. Instead, it is a revolution. There is a difference between the two. Mind is dropped and suddenly you find no mind is there. It has always been there, but the mind, like a rock, was blocking, was clouding, making you confused, and was not allowing you to see that which is. So it is not an evolution. And you ask, is it possible without a struggle and anguish? It has nothing to do with struggle and anguish. No mind has nothing to do with struggle and anguish really. It does not come out of struggle or anguish. Anything that comes out of struggle will carry the wounds within. Even if those wounds are healed, the scars will be carried. It will again be a continuity. The struggle and continuity is not for the no mind. The struggle and anguish arises because the mind struggles to keep itself in power. The fight is given by the mind. The mind does not want to go, instead the mind wants to stay. The mind has become so powerful that it possesses you now. It says, no, I am not going to get out. I am going to stay here. All struggle and anguish is therefore because of the mind. No mind has nothing to do with it. And you will have to go through this anguish and struggle. If you do not go through the anguish, the mind is not going to leave you. And again I repeat, no mind is not born out of your struggle. Out of your struggle only evolves the mind, maybe somewhat stranger. No mind comes without any struggle. The rock gives you the struggle. It does not want to move. It has remained in that place for centuries. Therefore, you are to remove it first. The mind resents and says, what spring are you talking about? There is none. I have been here for centuries and I know there is none. Forget all about this. But you want to remove the rock. The rock is heavy. It is rooted in the earth. It has remained there for so long. It has attachments. So it does not want to go. And it knows nothing of the spring. But you will have to remove the rock. Unless this rock is removed, the spring will never arise. This is what Buddha is telling Subhuti. You have to continuously help the people to reach to the other shore, and at the same time you have to make effort that you do not grow the roots. The no mind has nothing to do with your acts. The mind will not go. You will have to hammer and you will have to do 1001 things for the mind to vanish. Mind wanders. Is the very idea of no mind, which seems to be in the mind and yet transcending the mind, a seed-like form of the no mind. No, it is not so. The seed of no mind does not exist in the mind. Mind cannot contain even the seed of no mind. Mind has no space to contain it. No mind is vast. It's like an infinite sky. How can it be contained in a tiny space that we call mind? The mind is already full of thoughts, desires, fantasies, imaginations, and memories. So there is no space for no mind. In the first place, it is very tiny. It cannot contain the no mind. In the second place, it is so full, overcrowded, and so noisy. The no mind is silent. Mind is noisy. Mind cannot contain it. Also, the mind has to cease. In that very cessation comes the beginning of a new life. A new being, a new realm. Mind wanders. Can one meditate on these mind transcending concepts like eternity, nirvana, and death? Mind always wanders. Those so-called mind transcending concepts are still concepts and out of the mind. When you are thinking of eternity, what do? You will think. You are thinking of nirvana. What is going to happen? Your mind will spin and weave, and your mind will give you beautiful ideas about nirvana. But that will be all the work of the mind. What can you think about death? What will you do if you think about death? You do not know. How can you think about? How can you think anything about that which you do not know? Mind is absolutely capable in repeating the known. However, with the unknown it is impotent. You do not know eternity. All that you know is time-bound. Even when you think of eternity, it is nothing but lengthened time or stretched time. Still it is time. What do you know about Nirvana? All that you have heard about it or read about it is indeed not Nirvana. You will recall, Lao Tse says the word God is not God. The word Nirvana is not Nirvana and the concept of Nirvana is not Nirvana. The word God is not God and all the pictures and all the statues that have been made of God have nothing to do with Him because He has no name or form. That which is formless and nameless cannot be put into any form. And what are you going to think about death? How can you think about death? You have heard a few things. You have seen a few beings, a few people dying. But you have never seen death. And when you see people dying, you believe that you know death. When you see a man dying, what do you see? Now he breathes no more. That's all you see. His body has become cold. This is all you can see. What more? Is this death? Body becoming cold or breathing is stopping? Is death? Is this all? What has happened to the innermost core of the person? You cannot know without dying. You cannot know without experiencing death. The only way to know the unknown is to experience it. So these concepts would not help. They may rather, on the contrary, strengthen the mind. Because the mind will say, look, I can even supply you mind transcending concepts. See what am I? See what I am doing for you. Keep me with you always. I will help you to become enlightened. Without me you will be nowhere. Without me, how can you think about death and nirvana and eternity? I am therefore absolutely essential. Without me, you will not be anything at all. No, these meditations would not help. You have to see this. Mind is not going to help at all in any way. When you can see the point that mind is helpless, in that very state, there is silence and all stops. If the mind cannot do anything, then nothing is left to do. Suddenly all thinking is paralyzed. It is pointless. In that paralysis, you have the first glimpse of no mind. Remember, just a small window will open first. In that stopping of the mind, you will have the taste of no mind for the first time. In that, and then things will start moving. Then it will be easier for you to get lost into the boundarylessness. You cannot meditate. You have to go into it. Meditating upon it is a pseudo-activity. It is the way to avoid or escape. You are afraid of death, but you think about death. You are afraid of Nirvana, but you think about it. Thinking gives you a feeling that you are capable even of thinking about death and nirvana. Mind is very cunning. It cannot explode while you are thinking. About what are you thinking does not matter. While you are thinking, mind cannot explode. Mind will be enjoying it, and in that very enjoyment, you are thinking, you are exploding. It feels like that I am pushing over my limit and get afraid of becoming schizophrenic. You need not be afraid of ever becoming schizophrenic, because you already are. And for that matter, everybody is. Because mind is schizophrenic. Mind knows nothing of unity. It is always split. It has always alternatives. To be or not to be. To do this or not to do this. That mind is always indecisive. Even if you choose something, it is only a part of the mind that chooses and the other part remains against it. The mind is never total. So mind is schizophrenic. You need not be afraid of that. To be in the mind is to be schizophrenic. Only Buddhas are beyond it. The whole humanity is schizophrenic more or less. Is a question of degrees. When your schizophrenia go beyond a point, then you have to visit the psychiatrist. But the difference is only of degrees. The difference is only of quantity, not quality. Even between you and your psychiatrist, there is only a difference of degree. Remember, mind will not help. Mind cannot help. Mind can only hinder. Seeing this, no mind arrives. It is not that you have to breathe. It arrives on its own. Buddha tells Subhuti, you have to remember this. No mind comes on its own. It is not the growth of the mind. It is the transcendence when mind is no more.